Hey guys, Mike here, the Detroit Borg, with a look at the third and final Galaxy Tab 4 in the series, the 10.1-inch. So this is the largest. I've already looked at the 7-inch and 8-inch, and once again, this is pretty much the same tablet, just blown up to size. It even has the same screen resolution, just over 10.1 inches rather than 7-inch or an 8-inch. Now the interesting thing here is that this is considerably cheaper than the Tab 3 from last year. This starts off at $349. You can pick it up for $319 right now on Amazon, but last year it started off at $399. So a big price cut here. Now this gives up the Atom processor from last year. This goes with the same quad-core processor in the 7-inch and 8-inch model, which is clocked at 1.2 gigahertz. So we should see the same scores in terms of benchmarking. So again, 10.1 inch display, 1280 by 800, good for 149 pixels per inch. That's pretty low. Now the Wi-Fi version comes standard with 16 gigs, but like the Tab 3, you have a 64 gig SD card slot for expandable storage. Alright, so let me just cut this seal so we can get into the box here. Flip it around. Should get a little tray here to slide out. There we go. Galaxy Tab 4, a little bit upside down here. Alright, so let's go ahead and pop this out of here. So as you can see, we have our dusty Tab 4. On the back, we have a piece of plastic covering the back panel. So let's go and peel that off. And then on the front, we have a label covering the glass. All right, so let's set that aside for just a moment while we clear the packaging contents. So inside we have our literature, which includes a Samsung Galaxy Tab Quick Start Guide. Pretty basic there. And we also have Owning the Galaxy has its rewards, just an incentive to register your Tab 4. We also have, what else is here? Software upgrade instructions, pretty basic. And then we have the health and safety and warranty guide in multiple languages. Not much interesting reading there. We should also get our peripherals here. So we have our USB wall charger. Now this has a glossy finish as opposed to the matte finish on the other Tab 4 products. We also have our matching white micro USB 2.0 charging cable. And we just have a few more bits of plastic to remove. We have one covering the camera lens. We also have another one covering the IR blaster right there. And we're just going to remove this serial number sticker on the back, which also indicates that it's 16 gigs. Now, before we take a closer look, let's just tap and hold the power button to boot it up for the first time. As you can see, the power button is up toward the corner here on the left side. So thankfully, they've retained the stereo speakers on this tablet, so you have nice stereo speakers on the left and right. It makes a huge difference here. All right, so let's take a look at the design of the Galaxy Tab 4 10.1 inch, which is pretty much the same dimensionally as last year. It's a little squarer this time. It doesn't have that round design from last year's Tab 3, but dimensionally, they have the same thickness, width, and height. It is slightly lighter now. It's closer to 1 pound, 1.07 pounds. So that's great because they retain the same battery size and overall dimensions, but reduce the weight to make it even more comfortable to handle. So down here you see our new Android keys, which are not backlit. So you have a recent apps button, you have your home button and back button. Now if you tap and hold the recent apps button, it takes you to your menu settings. And as you can see here in the home screen, it just takes you to your home screen editor. You also have your home button. So if you double tap the home button, it takes you to S Voice. But if you tap and hold it, it takes you to Google Now. So you have two voice assistants in here. If you tap and hold the back button, it takes you to your multi-window tray, which I'll explore a bit later. Now up top, you have a 1.3 megapixel front-facing camera, which records video in VGA. Notice there is no ambient light sensor, which was on the Tab 3 last year. Also, there is no LED notification light here. The Tab 3 did have backlit Android keys, and again, that's missing here. So in order to reduce pricing, they did reduce a few features. Now the back panel wraps around the edges and has this kind of faux leather finish without the stitching we see on Samsung's higher end tablets. So if you look at the corner down here again, you can see that that plastic wraps around the edges with that nice grain to it. So it gives you a little more of a grippable texture to it as opposed to a glossy finish like we had with the Tab 3. Now toward the back we have that 3.15 megapixel fixed focus camera, good for 720p HD video, and it's pretty flush to the surface back here. Notice there is no LED flash like you get with the more premium tablets from Samsung. Now toward the top edge, you'll find an IR LED blaster. As you can see here, it's a little off center because the camera module is right next to it toward the center. We also have a micro SD card slot, which supports 64 gig cards. As you can see here, it pops out like so. You can pop it in, seal it up, that little flap there. We also have our volume rocker as well as our sleep-wake power on and off button. Now on the left side near the power button is our headphone jack along with our left stereo speaker. So thankfully they did retain the stereo speakers from the Tab 3, which isn't the case for the other Tab products. Again, here is the right stereo speaker. Toward the bottom we have our micro USB port. And if you look closely, next to that USB port is the single microphone. Now, as you know, Samsung sells some other 10-inch tablets. So we have a 10.1-inch Note 2014 edition, and we have the 10.1-inch Pro tablet. This is the Tab Pro. This has a much higher resolution display, has better cameras with an ambient light sensor, also has backlit Android keys, vibration motors. The display has a pixel density of 299 versus of 149, so huge difference here. Also, the Note has 3 gigs of RAM as opposed to 1.5 gigs on the Tab 4 or the 2 gigs on the Tab Pro. We're going to take a look at benchmark scores in those tablets when we compare them later in this video. And of course, cameras are a big story here. We have 8-megapixel autofocusing cameras with an LED flash. And of course, the Note series has a stylus with all the software features that come with it. Now, dimensionally, they're very similar, but the Tab 4 is a little taller, at least in landscape orientation, than the other tablets. Alright, so let's go and take a look at the user interface. Again, this is Android 4.4.2 with the latest version of TouchWiz, which takes after the Tab Pro and the Note series. So you can see here that we can pinch in and out to see all of our home screens. We can also add new home screens. We can rearrange them or we can pitch them just by taking them up to remove. You also have your drop-down notification shade right here with your new toggles. So you can see the redesigned toggles, which are much simpler looking, much cleaner looking and brighter. You can see we have Wi-Fi location sound. There is no vibration motor in here. You also have your sliders here for brightness as well as volume. Now, as you can see here, there is no auto mode. Again, there is no adaptive ambient light sensor. You also have your settings here, so you can individually adjust your volume from this control as well. And we have multi-window mode, which a lot of people don't want to accidentally activate each time. So if you toggle this off, that means you can no longer swipe in from the right to activate it. So if I activate it again, there you go. There you go. Pops up. A lot of people don't like that because it constantly gets in the way when you mean to swipe to the right. Instead, it brings up the multi-window mode. You also have screen mirroring, which again allows you to mirror this device's screen wirelessly to an all-share cast-equipped device like a Samsung Smart TV. We also have Smart Stay, which watches for the presence of your eyes and prevents the screen from going to sleep. If it doesn't see it, you'll get a little warning up here in the drop-down notification shade that the camera can't see your eyes and it will go to sleep. You also have power saving mode and blocking mode. Now, if you go up here, you can see all of your toggles, which includes airplane mode. You can also go up here to edit your toggles. So if you want to add additional ones or remove them or rearrange them, you can. So as you can see here, you can just drop them and it bumps them out of the way. You can also toggle off brightness and volume controls. If you don't want those to appear in your drop-down shade, you can do that as well. I'm not sure why you would, but you can. And then you also have your settings, quick access to your settings panel right here. So we have device, controls, general, and connections, and we'll talk a bit about that a little later. Now you also have your notifications, so you can just tap on them. It takes you right to wherever, whatever app pushed that notification. You can also clear them out of the way just by tapping this X button right there. Now if you want to get to these control panels up here, all you have to do is tap and hold on them. So for example, we have blocking mode, which is a do not disturb function. So this allows you to adjust them. So you can turn off your notifications or turn off your alarms or select which one you want. You can select always or specific times of day. So for example, if you want to set a specific time of day to turn off your notifications, you can. So for example, if I want to turn them off at midnight, I can do that like so. Now, as you can see here, they've given us 2 home screens to work with, and you can tap on each one of these icons down here to select which home screen you want to look at. They've given us some of these widgets, which you can remove if you prefer just by tapping and holding on them or move them around. As you can see here, everything moves out of the way for you. They've given us lots of Google apps all organized into a Google folder. And of course, we have the standard array of Samsung apps, which includes the calendar. We also have the standard WebKit browser, the Memo app, which is quite nice. You can record voice memos, you can take photographs, and of course you can write text in here. You also have your Contacts app, you have the Gallery app, and then you have your Dropbox app, as well as the integrated music and video player settings, the Handcom Office Viewer for viewing Word, Excel, or PowerPoint documents. This is an app that's included but doesn't come pre-downloaded. So you get the icon, but when you click on it, you actually have to download the app. You also have the email app as well. Now in the lower right corner, we have our app drawer. So as you can see here, we have a tab for our apps, our widgets, our downloaded apps. If you go down here, if you go to the apps drawer, you can see if we go to the menu settings up here, we have the option to create folders, set wallpaper, and a few other things, but you can also uninstall or disable apps. First, let's go and create a folder here. So we're just going to do test. Click OK. So now we have a folder here. And as you can see here, they've created a page just for foldered items. Now, if you want to add items to that folder, you'll have to go up to edit again. So this gives you your editor within the app drawer. So now I can drag and drop these apps to that folder, or I can just go right to the folder and go to plus and select the apps I want to add. So for example, Netflix, Watch On, etc., etc. Click done. So as you can see here, we have a folder full of our apps, and we can also drag and drop this to the home screen if we want. Now, when we're in the app drawer, we can go up here to settings, go to uninstall or disable apps, and we can select specific apps to uninstall or disable. Now, only certain apps are eligible. Some of these are permanent. You can't do anything about them. They stay with the tablet no matter what, but some of these can be disabled and some of them can be uninstalled. Now, most of them cannot be uninstalled. So for example, the memo app up here, if we select that, we can disable the app. We can't uninstall it. Now, if we disable it, it pretty much just hides. It disappears. Some of these apps I can uninstall, such as Geekbench 3, so I can uninstall it, which I don't want to do right now because I want to use it later. But if you go up here now, if you go to show disabled apps, you'll see all the apps you disabled. They're still there, they're hidden, but you can also reactivate it if you prefer. Click done. Now, if you want to drag and drop any one of these apps to the home screen, you just tap and hold on it. It takes you to the home screens. So now you can go up here to create a folder. You can go up to app info to find more information about the app, or you can cancel. Now, as you can see down here, we have this little editor which appears, so we can drag and drop it over this editor and drop it into place once we're satisfied. If you tap and hold on the home screen, you get to the option to set wallpaper, select your apps or widgets, create a new folder, or create a new page. If you tap and hold the power button, you also get the option to shut it down, select airplane mode, restart it, or select mute or not. Now, as you can see here, there is no vibration mode. That's because there is no vibration motor in here. Now, if you tap the volume button and select the settings icon, you can individually control the volume for notifications, media, and the system. Now, we also have our multi-window mode here. Now, this allows us to open up two windows at once so we can interact with two apps at once. So, for example, we can drag and drop YouTube here, and then we can drag and drop the browser. So, as you can see here, we have two windows side by side, which we can resize like so. So, here I have one of my YouTube videos. I can click play. I can resize it, and I can continue browsing the web in the right-hand side. Now, when you're interacting with these windows, as you can see, they outline in blue. So, when you tap the circle icon down here, you can see we can now switch from left hand to right hand side. We can also select text from one side of the window and post it into the other side of the window. We can resize this window to full screen, or we can close it. Now again, if we want to interact with that window, you have to tap it to make sure it's highlighted. And as you can see here, we now have those same controls on the other side. This is also important when interacting with the back button here. So if you want to go back on this window, you have to make sure it's highlighted in blue and click back. Now, at the bottom of the multi-window mode is this little expandable folder, which gives you the option to edit the content in here. So you can add additional apps into this window, or you can drag and drop them out here. So for example, if I want the memo app, which I think is good to have in here, you can do so. And of course, you can rearrange them as well. Now let's go and take a look at our settings. So under the settings panel, everything is organized in 10 tabs. We have connections, devices, controls, and general. Under connections, we have our Wi-Fi settings, Bluetooth, airplane mode, data usage information. We also have location information, which apps are using that. And we also have our network settings. So we have VPN and printing. And of course, we do have printing integrated into this tablet because it is running Android 4.4. Now, if we toggle on nearby devices, this allows other devices to remotely access the media on this tablet. We also have screen mirroring in here as well. Now, under device, we have our sound settings, display. We have the multi-window mode, which you can toggle off. We have lock screen, which has a few things to look at here. So under lock screen, we can enable shortcuts. If we tap on shortcuts, we can add new ones to the lock screen. So for example, if we want Chrome, we can click that. Or if we want to remove one of them, such as the standard browser, we can do so. So if we go to the lock screen now, we have these quick access toggles for launching our favorite apps. We also have our wallpaper settings, and there's one interesting thing to look at here, and that is lock screen wallpapers. So you can select travel wallpapers, which works with TripAdvisor to load a sort of travel theme wallpaper every 3 hours or greater. If you select here, you can select 3 hours, 6 hours, 12 hours, or 24 hours. So now if we go to the lock screen, we'll have this travel themed wallpaper. So in this case, it's the Dominican Republic. We also have our fonts, so we can select our font styles, which also allows us to download additional fonts from the Samsung App Store. We have our notification panel settings, which I looked at earlier. We have accessibility and blocking mode settings. We have our controls, which includes palm motion, which includes screen capture and mute to pause. Now, if you swipe on the screen using the edge of your palm, it does a little screen grab for you. In fact, it pops up here in your drop-down notification sheet, and you can access it in any app you prefer. Now, under general, we have accounts, so we can add additional accounts such as email accounts, Google accounts, We can sync with Twitter or Facebook, Dropbox accounts, that sort of thing is all in here. Cloud, so we can set up our cloud storage, which includes Samsung's cloud storage as well as Dropbox, which is trying to find right now. We also have backup and reset options. We have date and time options, accessories. Then we have our application manager, so we can see what's downloaded. The SD card, we can also see what apps are running. We can also tap on them to see them. We also have default applications, users, which allows us to add additional users for that multi-user mode. We have battery, power saving mode, storage. So you can see how much storage we're using up. I haven't downloaded much here or taken many photos, so you can see how much storage is left after the system takes its cut. Then we have security. We have about this device, so we can see the latest version of Android right there, 4.4.2. Now let's talk about users and multi-user mode. So if you go to users and go up to plus here, you can add two types of users. You can do a full standard user or a restricted profile, which is good for children, for example. This allows very strict access to what this tablet can do. Now, if you go to users here, basically select OK. It's like adding another owner to this tablet. So let's go and set it up now. So basically what will happen is that they can log in with their own Google account and have access to their own Play Store, their own content. They can add their own apps, change their own wallpaper, that sort of thing. So now with the new user activated, you can see here I have two users to select from the lock screen. So I have me, as you can see here, or I have this new user, which I can select to unlock. So now it takes me into the setup process for this new user. Now, if I want to get back to my account, just tap on myself in the lock screen here. You can see it even changes my wallpaper back to my lock screen wallpaper. Unlock it, and I can go ahead and delete this account if I want. Now, let's quickly talk about the restricted profile here. So let's go and select this. Now, when you set this up, you do have to set a passcode or lock screen or something on your account so that the other user can't have access to it. So, for example, we can select a pattern here. I'm just going to do this, click continue. So basically, I can configure this account now. I can name this person, so I can say kid. And I can also change the profile picture. So for example, I select the profile picture, I can take an image or select one from my gallery. And now I can select specifically what apps this account has access to. So for example, I can select Netflix. But also under Netflix, you get this little settings icon. So you can disable profile switching under that app, but some other apps have a few more things here, such as play movies and TV. So if I select this and select the gear icon, I can now restrict certain content based upon age. So I can restrict that here. Once I've selected the apps they have access to, I can go to that account and show you exactly what they're going to experience here. So I'm going to select kid here. Swipe to unlock. So as you see here, they basically have a home screen which they can customize. They can go to their app drawer and add the available apps that they have access to, such as Netflix. So we can tap and hold it and drag it to the home screen. They also have that drop-down notification shade. As you can see here, they have the profile in the left side. And if you want to select that to jump to the lock screen to change the profile, you can do so as well. Now under the notification panel settings, we also have something called recommended apps. Now this is on by default, but you can toggle this off. But basically what happens with recommended apps is if you connect a pair of headphones, as I just did right there. If we go to the drop-down shade now, you have these recommended apps that are audio-specific or media-specific, such as YouTube, the music player, Watch On, and the video player. You can also edit this by going up here to select specific apps you want to add. But alternatively, you can also go to the notification panel here, go up to recommended apps, and as you can see here, you can see the ones that are available for recommended apps, and go up to edit as well to specify which apps you would prefer. Now, instead of digging through these menus to find what you're looking for, you can also just go up to search. So for example, if you want to find that multi-user mode, just tap in user. You can see right there, takes you right to that panel. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our keyboard here. I'm just going to go to the memo app, create a new memo. So you can see we have a full QWERTY keyboard with a number row as well as these directional keys, which is very nice to have. So you can see here that when caps lock is activated, you get a little icon in the lower or in the upper right corner of the shift key. You also have your settings here. So if you tap on it, it takes you to your settings panel, which includes things like continuous input. So if you enable this, you now have a swipe-like keyboard. So let me show you this. There we go. That also works pretty well. Now, if you tap and hold this, you get to more options. So we have our voice input keyboard. We have our handwriting recognition keyboard. We have our clipboard, as well as our emoticon keyboard and our keyboard sizes here. So if we select this, we have our split keyboard, which is available only on the 8-inch and 10.1-inch, not on the 7-inch. You can move this around. So this gives you more of a thumb typable keyboard, which is very handy on a large tablet like this, especially in landscape orientation. We also have that floating keyboard, and we can go back to our normal keyboard as well. Now, while we don't have the stylus, we have the same handwriting keyboard that's also available on the Note series. We can use our finger, or we can add our own stylus. here. And it recognizes punctuation as well. Now let's quickly take a look at the Watch On app and set this up. So what you have to do is establish where in the world you are so it can find your available services. All right, so I'm just going to select my service provider. So now you see I have two tabs here. I have on TV and on demand, so I can see what's on TV right now. If I want to watch that, all I have to do is tap on it, click watch this channel, and it will broadcast the IR code to my TV. But first, I have to set up my equipment here. So let me go to setup. I'm going to select my Samsung Smart TV, click next. Turn on TV. It's basically programming the device to recognize your TV. And if that's the correct code, click OK, click Next. And then I have to select my service, which is Comcast, click Next. Send it to my set-top box. Again, if that is correct, we're going to click OK. And so now I have my remote control. I can input my channel numbers. I can select my channel from here, volume, power things off, that sort of thing right from here. And then if I go ahead and click Watch, it's turning to HBO for me. And I can start watching my programming all without digging through the menus on my television. All right, so let's briefly take a look at the camera app. So we do not have tap to focus here, and we do not have tap to auto exposure. That happens automatically, or you can select that manually. You can take your photograph. You also have your effects here. So you have grayscale, sepia, negative, or no effect. You also have pinch in and out to zoom. It's just digital cropping, of course. You can also select your video camera from this toggle right here. You can record video. You can pause it or stop it. You can't pinch in and out on video, so that is only available on still. And then you can also go up to your settings right here. So you have your still camera, you have your video camera, which is only 720, and then you have your settings for location tags, volume key for zooming, guidelines, contextual file naming. You can also reset everything back to default. So you can see there's not a lot of options here. Now you can also select from the front-facing and rear-facing camera. And again, this is a pretty mediocre camera, 1.3 megapixels with VGA video only. Let's go back to the front camera. You can also select more options here from this drag out right there. So you can see you have your exposure settings, which you can set manually, and then you have other things here. You can also rearrange these just by tapping and holding on them and move them around on this grid here. Now, if you go to photo size, you can see what's available here, 3.2 megapixels or 2.4 megapixels. If you go to 3.2 megapixels, it's a 4x3 photograph instead of a widescreen 16x9 photograph. So that's something to also keep in mind. Now, we also have our modes down here, which allows us to select auto, beauty face, sound and shot, panorama, sports, night, and that sort of thing. Now, if you look at our Geekbench 3 scores, you can see the Tab 4 is pretty low end. Now, if you look at the Tab Pro and the Note 10.1 2014 edition, you can see these are much higher spec'd. They have much higher end processors. This one has 3 gigs of RAM, this one has 2 gigs of RAM, and the results are pretty apparent. Now, predictably, because they all have the same 1.2 gigahertz quad-core processor, all have 1.5 gigs of RAM, the Geekbench 3 scores are all identical. All right, guys, so let's talk about some of the strengths and weaknesses of the Tab 4 10.1 inch. Now, I think some of the biggest strengths here are going to revolve around the price. So at $349 and $320 on sale, I think this is a pretty good deal. You get 16 gigs of storage along with a 64 gig SD card slot. Again, it's a fairly large tablet that's very lightweight, pretty good battery life, and seems to be pretty indestructible. It's definitely a great tablet for those who want a larger tablet but don't necessarily care about the screen resolution. The other strength here are the speakers. So if you're going to use your tablet for movie watching without your headphones, this is going to be one of the best sounding tablets at any price. So those stereo speakers definitely make a big impact here and certainly are much better than the ones on the 7-inch and 8-inch Tab 4. And of course, you got the latest version of Android 4.4.2 with an updated version of TouchWiz, which is actually pretty decent. So you don't get too many features with TouchWiz. I think you just get the right amount of them and only the ones that are particularly useful without bogging down system performance too much. Now, in terms of cons, this is going to vary by user. But for me, the biggest one is the display. The resolution is pretty poor. Most people are used to much higher resolution displays either on their laptop or their computer, desktop computer, or their phone. And certainly 149 pixels per inch is going to be noticeable, especially when you're reading text. The other problem here is going to be performance. Again, we're running TouchWiz on fairly low-end hardware, so it's definitely noticeable here. It's a little laggy, especially if you're used to the performance of other products. But again, it's not a deal breaker here. It's still a very usable tablet that gets the job done with some interesting features. And of course, these have terrible cameras. There's no autofocusing, the color reproduction is very poor on them, and it's just not a camera you're going to be using for day-to-day use. You're probably going to prefer your cell phone camera. These cameras are really there when you need them. They're kind of a utility more than a feature. Now, in terms of which one I prefer, it's kind of a toss-up. I'm a big fan of the 7-inch with that small form factor and the small bezel, but I think the 8-inch is the right size. It actually seems to be a better performing tablet for whatever reason. I think the 8-inch is the perfect size, that kind of mid-size form factor, while the 8-inch tends to be a little bit big, a little bit bulky, and with such a low-resolution display, it's kind of hard to really get behind the 10.1-inch, but for a lot of people, that's not an issue, and it's quite a bargain for a large tablet. So for me, I think the sweet spot is going to be the Tab 4 8.0. So I'm curious what you guys think. What size tablet would you prefer? The 10.1-inch, the 8-inch, or the 7-inch? All right, guys, so that's going to do for me in this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again in the next video.